Okay, good morning. We are going to be doing this copy of a drawing by Raphael, who you've all probably heard of. It's an incredibly delicate little drawing. I believe it's Silver Point. Silver Point is, you're just drawing with like a thin silver wire or a sharpened silver stylus. So you can see that the line work is incredibly delicate. Let me lock my focus here, okay. And to get an idea how small this is 10 centimeters. So that is only about, it's 4 inches across. So it's a very small drawing. This head is probably about 1.5 to 2 inches wide. We're gonna draw it a little bigger than that. One thing I really like about Raphael is you can very clearly see his hand direction. He's right-handed, and he slants almost all his shading down into the left using his right hand. And there's some very subtle variations in line directions as these hatching lines pass across the forms. It's almost like if you picture a little stream and the water as it goes around the rocks and branches that are in the bottom of the stream bed, it's sort of like that. It's like his hand is flowing over these forms and very subtly curving around them, but never really breaking from that one direction. To set this drawing up, we're going to draw the overall structure. There we go. So notice the head's on a little bit of a tilt. So let's draw an egg slightly tilted to the left. And then we're going to think about the line of the eyes, which is curving slightly down below center. And I don't know if you're believing me on that, but it's pretty clear to me that in this pose, we should expect to see the eyes below the center of the head. You see that? There's the top part of the head, there's the bottom part. And that's because the head is tipped down. When we tip our heads down, it lowers our eye line in relation to the rest of the head. So that's very important to set up correctly. We've got this angle. The head is turned just slightly to our right, so we're gonna drop this vertical line, but curve it slightly to the right, and this one curves more significantly downward. Did Raphael make these lines when he did this drawing? Doesn't look like it. You can't erase with Silver Point, so it seems like highly unlikely that he would have done that, but. We're gonna look at eye spacing now. So we can fit a little more than an eye between the eyes. So that's about like this. The distance between the outside corner of this eye and the cheek is less than one eye, and that's because the head's turned a little. So we're gonna mark the outside of this eye and then to the cheek. It's a relatively small distance. And on this side, we've got about one eye width between here and here. So the turn to the head is very subtle. If you weren't thinking about it, you might just figure the head was directly facing you, and you would be wrong, and that would make success unlikely. It's really important to think through what you're seeing in a pose like this. Because the head is tipped down a little, notice that the eyelids are very curved. So, and they curve up higher towards the outside. So I'm gonna start with drawing these eyelid forms like this. And they're curving up towards the outside because of this overall curvature of the head. I'm sure that makes sense to you because the heads are not flat. And I'm just gonna, instead of drawing the eye shape, really the main feature we're seeing in these eyes is the lids. So I'm just gonna draw the eyelids like that. And what we can see of the eyes is relatively, it's much narrower than the lids, so I'm just gonna draw these openings. And I'm gonna just drop a little bit of shadow under these openings, leaving this distance here, which is the distance, the thickness of the lower lid. Now I've kind of gone into a little more detail than I normally would this early on in the drawing. This is how some artists work. They just go from one resolved detail to the next. I don't usually teach this way because you're a little more apt to mess it up if you don't do a little more shadow mapping at the beginning, but let's just see what happens this time. We're going to indicate the bridge of the nose. With some shading on either side, keeping it more or less centered between these eyes, although slightly to the right, because this space is a little less foreshortened than this space. And to find the length of the nose, we're going to triangulate today. We're going to go from the pupil, or I'm estimating where the pupils would be, down to the tip of the nose. And let's try that again. Pupil to pupil. Notice if I make an equilateral triangle, it's going to land to the left of the tip of the nose, and that's because, again, of the turn of the head. So try to sketch roughly an equilateral triangle to get the distance to the tip of the nose. And then we're going to pull that tip of the nose to the right of the tip of the triangle to get the nose to project out slightly from the face. Because the head's tipped downward, we're not seeing up into the nostrils at all. So we have this first curve, and then we have the parentheses, and that's it. And we're now trying to relate the tip of the nose to the curve of the upper lip, and it sort of seems to be right below the tip of the nose. And that's because the lips are kind of pouty. Can you feel that the, because this should really be set back behind the tip of the nose, but instead, it's pretty far forward, which brings it in our drawing slightly to the right. Notice that this wing of the mouth is very relatively elongated, and this wing is very short. I hope that's clear. All I did was I just related this curve here to this curve. And I would have expected this bottom curve to be more to the left, but instead I'm locating it directly below the nose. And that's what gives the mouth that kind of pouty expression. Now, obviously, I'm going to have to extend downward for my chin and locating the chin sort of directly under the center of the mouth. And that mouth is about a third of the way down, so I have to add about a half an inch to the bottom of my drawing, and I'm just going to always indicate up above that I need to add a little bit to the top whenever that happens. And the angle of the jaw is out here, and it curves up. We already located this cheekbone. And on the other side, the angle of the jaw is much further out to the left. And we also located this cheekbone. Now, looking at my drawing, I'm feeling like this eye is crowding the bridge of the nose a little. So I'm just going to scoot it out about a quarter of an inch. If you're following closely, you might need to do the same thing. It would be a mistake to go in any more detail before sort of locating the neck. Notice that this intersection here is level with the philtrum. So if I go straight across, that helps me find where that should be. And this intersection here is level with the outside corner of this mouth, roughly. So that's going to help me with that. This ear starts just a little bit above the level of the tip of the nose. And then we're just going to block in the hair. Let me show you what that means. We're just going to not think of it as a curve. We're thinking of it as a series of angled straight lines, because that's so much easier to estimate. So here's the ear. And notice that the drawing just makes a lot more sense after the hair is blocked in than before. The last thing I'm going to do before I take a momentary break is a little shadow mapping and first shading. So there's the main shadow under the neck. Here's the form shadow along the side of the head. Cast shadow under the bottom lip, form shadow under the chin, and some pockets of shadow around the eye sockets. And we always do our first shading very faintly so that if the shading reveals any construction errors, which it almost always does, we can, without any hesitation, go back and make corrections. So I'm going to use my left hand, but I'm going to shade in a right-handed direction here. Not the best technique, but I want you to shade in the right-handed direction. So if you're lefty, just do what I'm doing. And if you're right-handed, it'll be a lot easier to get this. But and you see what happens as soon as you can see the pattern of light and dark emerging, the construction of the drawing just becomes so much clearer. And this is the time also to erase construction lines and really take a hard look at what we have so far. And this is the time when it's very easy to move these shadow shapes around and create some kind of a correspondence between the drawing and the motif. We're not going to draw the child today, just the Madonna. So it's very hard to do a satisfying copy of a drawing that's this kind of perfect and delicate. You know, ours are going to look a little crude compared to Raphael, but that's why we've all heard of Raphael, because he knew what he was doing. I'm going to start changing some of these hair details into curves. Now that I've blocked it in, I know the general movements of the form. I can soften those hard lines that I started with. And if you're making a lot of corrections in your face structure, don't worry so much about the hair, but and I just noticed that this ear is in shadow, which I kind of missed on my first shading, and also the bottom of this mass of hair is in shadow. Up here where the hair comes into the light, it's just indicated with these few kind of wispy little directional strokes. Notice that these strokes follow the direction the hair is growing, but as soon as he gets into the shadows, he's going back to that first shading direction. So this is a massive image. It's from Google Arts and Culture, so we can really get in close and see some detail. Although this is really like looking at it under a microscope. Remember, this drawing was only 4 inches to begin with, so what we're looking at now is just really small. I think the most useful thing about seeing it this close is to see how little detail there actually is, which makes the overall effect of the drawing so much more impressive. I would expect a little more reflected light showing the bottom of the nose, but there really isn't much. There's this pretty deep shadow inside the philtrum. There's this halftone along the right side of the nose that sort of merges up here with the shadow along the bridge of the nose. There's a little bit of defining of the upper lip. But again, it's remarkably sort of out of focus. And again, this is such a more noble goal to be able to draw something so simple with so little detail that has such a convincing effect than the sorts of hyperrealism that we often see today, where every pore and every bead of sweat is drawn with photographic accuracy from a photograph. Yeah, when you zoom in, you expect to see so much more than is actually there. It's like, it's just this very graceful and subtle arrangement of shadows and halftones, all following this single shading direction. Now, along the side of the face here, this is where it feels like just his hand direction, but you see how the lines just subtly curve around the form. Again, like the water flowing over those rocks. And we've got this darkening behind the face down here that's bringing out just a little touch of reflected light along the side of the face. And moving up towards the eyes. Notice that this slope is about 50 degrees. This section of the eyelid is very straight. again, look at these curved shading lines coming around the lid that really show its roundness, and more curved lines for the lower lid. And then the curve changes directions as it sweeps over the cheekbone, like that. You can learn a lot doing a copy like this, even if your copy isn't that good, because you're asking your hand to make all these unfamiliar movements and to analyze the way someone with this level of mastery is translating form into line. So I wouldn't get too hung up on just how perfect the copy is. As you've probably heard me say before, like, doing a copy of a great drawing is like, especially a close copy like we're doing here, we're really trying to copy every line in more or less the same direction that Raphael made them. And when we finish the copy, we'll be able to say to ourselves, well, we looked at the whole drawing, because we looked at what the lines were doing in every section of the drawing. And it's sort of like when you read a book, you know you've read the whole book when you get to the last page. When you look at a drawing, the only way to really keep track of whether or not you've actually seen the entire drawing is to do a copy. And when your copy's done, you can tell yourself, yeah, I saw that whole drawing. If you don't copy it, you may have an impression of the drawing, but you haven't really looked at it. So before doing the other eye, I'm just going to deepen this shadow on the neck to bring out that reflected light at the bottom of the chin. And notice as we turn up that that reflected light goes away. It's probably bouncing up from the shoulder or something. So this boundary becomes much subtler. This really looks like a study from a live model, but we can't say for sure. There was an obvious obstacle to using live models in those days for representing the Virgin Mary, because or Jesus, because the model would have been someone that people knew, and it would have been hard for viewers to accept that this was a biblical figure, if they would recognize the model. That's why the figures in religious paintings that are mythological are often idealized compared to the portraits that were done by the same artists around the same time. Notice we can't see any iris or pupil, so let's not pretend we can. We just see this little darkening under the lid and above the lower lid. And try to remain disciplined about this shading direction. Here again on this cheek, we're seeing a little curve, a little change of the direction in this halftone. This is obviously a drawing on toned paper, but the Raphael did not use any white, so that means the highlights are created just as we're doing on white paper by creating halftones all around them, which is a little more laborious than would have been possible just by applying a little bit of white to the image. And the last step for halftone is really the forehead. It's just a little bit of shadow along this edge. I'm going to erase my shadow map. And notice that the highlight on the forehead is this upper region. And there's really a little bit of halftone that goes everywhere else, including right across between the eyebrows. When you're shading these halftones, just really try to use your lightest possible pressure, because we don't want these to compete with the shadows at all. A few little dark accents in the hair usually the last step in finishing a drawing like this is sort of disposing your darks, like just squint your eyes a little and make sure that the overall pattern of darks in your drawing corresponds to the overall pattern in the motif, pattern and placement. And there's a little bit of the outside of the helix on this ear. And a mere little suggestion of the tragus. And let's just get a little, work a little further down into the neck. There's a little hint of a plane change along here. Or that's a collar maybe. And a little more. This shadow doesn't hug the boundary of the neck. It sort of, the deepest part of it goes down into the pit of the neck, like this. Last thing I'm noticing is just to bring my hairline down a little closer to the forehead. And I think that will do it for me today. Thanks for watching.